My dear friends of the Barakpur Pastoral Region, I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Today we join once more in worship as we remain confined to our homes because of the COVID-19 protocols. But we are always reminded by the psalmist that our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. This is the day that the Lord has made. So let us rejoice and be glad in it. O Lord, open our lips and our mouths shall declare your praise. Let us join together in prayer. I want you to close your eyes with me as we pray. Gracious and loving God, in your grace you have allowed us to see a new day. Countless multitudes of people did not get the opportunity to see a day like today. So we who are alive, we now come before you to glorify your mighty name. Help us today to return to you our deepest thanksgiving and praise for what you have done for us. Help us always to be the salt of the earth, the light of the world, and that city built on a hill, that we may always bring glory to your precious and holy name. We pray through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please join me as we sing together the hymn, "To God Be the Glory." Praise God. Today, my dear friends, we are on the eve of our country's celebration of 58 years of independence. We are glad to call this place our home. There are many people of the world who are refugees in foreign lands. They have no land to call their own. The Hebrew people were like that. They did not have a country of their own for a very long time. They were slaves in Egypt. And then they made a journey for 40 years through the wilderness before they could settle in the land of Canaan. Today we can understand how it is to be without a country, because there are many foreigners who are migrants in our country who have fled their land to come here for refuge. So we give thanks to God for providing us with this nation, Trinidad and Tobago, that we can call our home. But as we live in this land today, we must be aware that we also belong to an eternal kingdom. And one day, God will call us to live with Him in that land. Today I will meditate from a famous scripture in which Jesus refers to that place. Our scripture today is taken from Mark chapter 12, verses 13 to 17. Let us hear the word of God as I read from the Good News Bible. Some Pharisees and some members of Herod's party were sent to Jesus to trap him with questions. They came to him and said, "Teacher, we know that you tell the truth without worrying about what people think. You pay no attention to anyone's status, but teach the truth about God's will for people. Tell us, is it against the law to pay taxes to the Roman emperor? Should we pay them or not?" But Jesus saw through their trick and answered, "Why are you trying to trap me? Bring a silver coin and let me see it." They brought him one, and he asked, "Whose face and name are these?" "The emperor's," they answered. So Jesus said, "Well then, pay to the emperor what belongs to the emperor, and pay to God what belongs to God." And they were amazed at Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God for his word. Amen. As we prepare to listen to a message from God's word, let us join as we sing prayerfully, "Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus," to reach out and touch him and say that we love him. Praise God. Let us join in prayer. O God, our loving Father, your holy word is a lamp which guides the feet of your people. Your word is a light unto our pathway. We pray that your word will enlighten us, that your word will guide us in all our journeys in the world. Bless our hearts as we listen to a message from your holy gospel. We pray through Christ our Lord. Amen. In today's gospel reading, we see two sets of people, the Pharisees and the Herodians, who traditionally hated each other. But today they come together as they try to trap Jesus into criticizing the Roman government so that he could be arrested and charged for sedition. This takes place during Jesus' last week on earth, and it is recorded in all three of the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. with almost the identical wording. This was a vital lesson for the disciples and is just as vital for each one of us today. The people asked Jesus, "Is it legal to pay taxes to Caesar?" They know full well that no one liked paying taxes to the corrupt Roman government. But they want Jesus to say something to get him in trouble with the government. But of course, they could not trap Jesus. Jesus takes a coin which was used for paying the taxes and he asks them, "Whose image is this on the coin?" They answered, "It is Caesar's image." Jesus says to them, "Well, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's and to God the things that are God's." What is Jesus saying in this very famous statement? Jesus is saying that the coin which has Caesar's image on it demonstrates that Caesar has political control over the people of Jerusalem, and therefore the people must pay their taxes to Caesar. But Jesus goes on to say that Almighty God, our Father, has placed his image upon our heart and our soul. You know, the book of Romans reminds us that when we receive Jesus as our Savior, that God put his seal upon us to show that we belong to God. And so, just as we render to Caesar what is due to Caesar, in the same way we must render to God what is due to God. The word render is translated from the Greek word which means to give back. The word is apodunai, which means an obligation to give back. So Jesus uses that word render and is suggesting that all of us have an obligation to give back to God. So my question for you today, my dear friends, is how much do you give back or you return to God whose image is upon you and who has done so much for you? Think about this. How much do you render to God? Today, as we pay homage to our beloved country, Trinidad and Tobago, we wonder how much we should give to our country and its leaders, and how much we should give to God. Jesus' answer reminds us that we have a kind of dual loyalty. Firstly, we owe loyalty to our country, which is the kingdom of the world, which is run by people like you and me. But we also belong to a higher kingdom in which Jesus is our King. In that kingdom, we live in a relationship with God, since God alone is the ruler over our soul. The great reformers Martin Luther and John Calvin understood the concept of a secular kingdom and a spiritual kingdom. They understood the difference between those two kingdoms. The secular or worldly kingdom is designed for us to live in this world in peace and harmony, where we will obey the laws of society and where we will pay our taxes, etc. This is where we have our jobs so that we could enjoy a good quality of life for our family. And this is where we contribute to the development of our nation. This is a kingdom where politicians like Caesar hold power. In this kingdom, the state is responsible for providing security, public transportation, other common services. And Jesus encourages us to be good citizens of our country. But if you must pay tributes and taxes to the state for its various services which it provides for you, what should you render to God, who has created you, who sustains you, in whom you live and move and have your being? God rules over everything. The Apostle Paul writes in the book of Romans, he says, "Render therefore to everyone what is due to them, such as taxes and duties and honor, wherever it is due." But Paul encouraged the church to be loyal also to God. He says, be loyal to the Roman emperor who is corrupt and godless. Whatever you think of the government, you may not agree with everything that they are doing, but you have a responsibility to your country. But as children of God, we hold God and our Savior Jesus Christ as greater than any government. And we should worship God beyond any loyalty to country with all our heart and all our mind and soul and strength. We should worship God above every power or ruler or authority of this world. He alone is God. Every knee shall bow before him and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, for the glory of God our Father. So today you might identify yourself with a country like Trinidad and Tobago or wherever you hold your citizenship, but your greatest identity should be that you are a child of the living God, and God's image is firmly planted on your heart, and your behavior and actions must identify you as such. We must project an image to the world that says without any doubt, I am a child of God. I am loyal to my Savior, for look, his portrait is indelibly stamped upon my heart. John chapter 18 says, Jesus is speaking to his accusers. He says, my kingdom is not of this world. My kingdom is from another place. Under the secular kingdom or the kingdom of this world, we have certain responsibilities, certain obligations about material things. But under the spiritual kingdom of Jesus Christ, we have obligations that involve things eternal, things everlasting. And Jesus is saying to us, let us be loyal and let us observe all the laws of the land. But more importantly, let us remember what holds priority in our lives. If Caesar requires you to pay your taxes, then pay it. But make sure that you also give to God what he demands. In the book of Acts chapter 22, the centurion asks Paul, he says, are you a Roman citizen? And Paul replies, I am. But Paul knew, as he writes in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 20, that while we are to be a blessing to the country in which we sojourn, our true citizenship is in heaven. You know, my dear friends, from next week, the church will be observing Stewardship Month. And it is a good time for us today to begin to consider what we render to our God and to our church. For many of us, we do not mind giving back to Caesar. We do whatever the state asks of us. As citizens of this country, the Lord expects us to pray for the authorities to obey the law and to support government policies. But friends, we sometimes have a real problem in giving back to God. Whether it is our time, our resources, we are often reluctant to demonstrate our love for God by doing his will and keeping his commandments. You know, John chapter 1 and verse 11 says that he came to his own, but his own received him not. At his crucifixion, the people said, we have no king but Caesar. Caesar is our king. They rejected the King of Kings and they accepted Caesar in his place. They espoused the secular kingdom and they rejected God's eternal kingdom. And sometimes we are like that. But today I am beseeching you, all of you, to recognize that God is sovereign over everything in this world. And you and I have a responsibility to give to God all who we are, not only our money, not only our time. So as we celebrate Independence Day tomorrow, and as we prepare for Stewardship Month in our church, I encourage all of you to be good citizens of our beautiful land. but let us always render to God that which belongs to God. Give the coin to Caesar, but give your full self, your entire self, wholly unto God. Friends, let us trust God. Let us love Him. Let us obey Him. Let us live for Him today and all the days that He gives us on this earth. Let us give our absolute surrender, our total worship, and our complete obedience to the holy will of God. And let us glorify Him forever and ever. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us join in prayer. We want to pray for each other today. Pray for those whom you love. Pray for those who are in need of prayer today. Lord, we come before you today from our homes. We cannot worship in our churches, but we know that you will hear our prayer because of your grace and your mercy, your strength, O Lord. Today we bring before you our loved ones who are struggling with grief, with illness, with addiction, Lord, with alienation from those whom they love. We ask you, Father, to lay your hand of healing gently upon their lives and pour out your balm of peace upon them. Lord, we bring before you those who celebrate birthdays and anniversaries, weddings, success in job or in examinations, which lift up your people and remind them of the goodness there is in life, despite all of the things which work to bring us down. Breathe your Holy Spirit upon your praying people today, dear Lord. We pray now for our country, this place which we call our home. We pray that our country will provide us with the security and the safety and opportunities for everyone, especially our children. Bless all our leaders today and grant them a heart for genuine service to the hungry and the homeless, the widows and the orphans and the aliens among us. Feed us today and always with your divine sustenance, that your people may experience true contentment physically and spiritually. And Lord, help us always that we may render our very best to you, because it is from you that all our blessings flow. We pray this prayer believing, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us join together as we sing our closing hymn, Faith of Our Fathers, Living Still.
Thank you.
Praise God. Let us join in the closing prayer and benediction. Gracious and loving God, we have come to the end of this worship, and we thank you for touching our lives in ways which we cannot explain. Thank you for taking us into your realms of glory. Continue to walk with us, O God, through every moment of our lives. And now may the blessings of God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit ever rest, remain, and abide with you, with all of your loved ones, and with all God's people and children everywhere, both now and forevermore. Amen. 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 God bless us all. Praise God.